Welcome to the Fairfax Sports Report. We are off the continuous loop that we've been on for quite some time, so we're bringing you all new, fresh information about the Northern Region's sports. I'm your host, BJ Kubarulis, alongside, of course, Paul Frummelt and John Marcario, all of us of the Connection newspapers. Before we get too far, I want to send out a couple of happy birthdays. Of course, we're talking about our famed director, Pete Mosisco, and my co-host here from the Connection newspapers, Paul Frummelt. Also a birthday boy this week, so when you see him out at the games this week, make sure to give him a happy birthday hug, Paul.
I like hugs.
Before we get too far in this action-packed show, we've got Herndon coach Gary Hall joining us later in the show to talk a little bit about the upcoming Fairfax Sports Network's Game of the Week against Westfield. And we've got an action-packed show talking about girls basketball from the region, boys basketball from the region, all the updates from the over the winter break. Thanks for joining us here on the Fairfax Sports Report. Want to thank our underwriters, of course, for making this show possible. We're talking about CCI Screen Printing, 703-978-0257 for all your screen printing needs. Quality Care Ford Service Center, they service all makes and models at 703-383-6299. Guys, it's been an action-packed month. We last left after our basketball preview. We're back now. We've got our reports from all the different districts. And as we know, and all the reporting that we do, we tabulate the Connection newspaper's Elite Eight. That is what we believe to be the best eight teams for boys and girls basketball in the Northern region. We want to get a chance to show our folks at home to put in perspective for them kind of what has happened over the break and show them who we think the top eight teams are. We'll go ahead and we'll start off with that graphic for the girls of the Northern region. You see Edison, still world beaters there at 12-1. Now, I will warn you, these are current through January 9th, so these do not include Tuesday's games. Edison at 12-1 with 32 votes from our voters. The previous week, they were, of course, number one. They've been a unanimous number one all the way from the start of the season until now. We'll tell you all about that one pesky loss on their overall record there later in our show. Oakton at 12-1 as well. Jasmine Thomas lighting it up for the Oakton Cougars, and Madison creeping up to third place from a fourth place tie in our previous week's poll. Lee flawless at 8-0. They did recently get a loss though last night. They lost. John Marcario will have a report on that game. TC Williams is going to be struggling. We'll tell you why they're going to be struggling in the next couple of weeks, but as of now they're at number 5. Westfield at 9-4. Billy Gibson's West Springfield Spartans right there at the number 7 spot. I see a lot of good things to come from them. And Centerville, Paul, a new team on our Connection newspaper's Elite Eight for the girls. Why don't you tell us about the boys of the Northern region, what they've been able to do, and where they've climbed in their rankings for the Elite Eight for boys.
Obviously, if you throw up that graphic for the boys' Connection top 10 Elite Eight, you see Herndon at number 1 retaining that top spot. 31 votes, they were previously also number 1. T.C. Williams jumping up from 5, getting that second spot. People are starting to notice that T.C. Williams is the real deal. Westfield, who will play Herndon this Friday at 10-3, they stay in the number 3 spot. South Lakes at 8-4, they dropped to the 4th spot from the 2nd spot previously. Wakefield at 10-1, they get 10 votes, and they were previously tied for 7th, and now they're in the 5th spot. Lake Braddock at 9-3, this is their first time in the rankings in the 6th spot. Madison at 10-3, they were previously in the 4th spot, and West Springfield was also previously in the 4th spot. They're tied for 8th with Woodson at 7-5.
Those are what we consider at the Connection newspapers to be the cream of the crop teams. Of course, if you have your Connection newspaper in front of you, you'll get a chance to look at what we believe to be the top teams. We're going to show you that graphic a little bit later in the show as well and give you a chance at home to see who those top teams are, who we believe to be the top teams. Again, to keep in mind, those records do not include Tuesday night's games. All right, let's talk a little bit about the Liberty District. We're going to start off with the Liberty District before we get a chance to talk to the Concord District's great coach in Gary Hall. He'll be coming up in just a couple of minutes to talk about the Fairfax Sports Network's Game of the Week, his Herndon Hornets taking on the Westfield Bulldogs at Herndon. Let's talk a little bit Liberty, though, guys. Liberty is, you know, in football, it's all about the Concord. In basketball, the script flips a little bit, and the Liberty kind of takes over the show. Let's throw up the Liberty District boys' standings on the screen for the folks at home so they can see who's been doing pretty well. John, why don't you tell us about that interesting top half of the Liberty District?
Well, the Liberty District is poised to be ultra-competitive throughout the year. South Lake's number one, 4-1, 8-4. They had a great game with Woodson, who's second. They're 4-1, 7-5 overall. Woodson's just got Zach Wilmot back 2 games ago, so they should start to be getting a little bit better. Madison's there at 3, where they're tied for first as well. They're 4-1, 10-3. They had an upset loss to Langley. BJ's going to talk about that in a little bit. Stonebridge and Langley are tied for fourth. It is. They're both 3-2. McLean is 1-4, 7-6 overall. Marshall 1-4, 5-8 overall. And Jefferson rounds out the Liberty. They are 0-5 in league play and 1-11 overall.
Okay, Jefferson struggling a little bit, looking to get on the board in the district. But guys, this is such an interesting district, especially the top half of the district. John, you mentioned it, a three-way tie for first place between South Lakes, Woodson, and Madison, all at 4-1 in the Liberty District. What an interesting district. I got a chance to see Madison versus Langley here in the early goings of this week on Monday. What an upset win for Langley High School. Travis Hess, the coach over at Langley, in his second year and helping his Langley Saxons defeat Madison. Madison was undefeated in the district coming into this game. They could have taken a stronghold at 5-0 overall in the district, but they did not because Langley upset them 44-40 at Langley. What a game it was. Ryan Davenport was held to 1 point for the Saxons in the first quarter. He blew up for 18 points on the night. That's just about his average, 19 points a game for Davenport. Madison was outscored 17-5 in the fourth quarter, made a couple of key turnovers and some situations where they didn't make the greatest decisions. A shot from the elbow with 30 seconds left in the game, which they didn't need, and a missed open layup, a turnover. So it was not the ideal situation for a Madison team that wasn't picked to do very well from the beginning of the season, but did climb into a position to actually make some noise in the Liberty District. So a little bit of a setback. Chris Kublank, the coach over at Madison, not very happy with his team after the game. His quotes to me were, they slept on them, meaning Madison slept on Langley, and I believe that is true. Madison had a big game coming up on Thursday, and it looks like they might have done a little bit of looking ahead. John, you got a chance to see two teams that we already mentioned, South Lakes and Woodson right there at the top half of that Liberty District. What did you see in that game? It was a pretty competitive game.
It was a pretty competitive game up until the final couple minutes of the fourth quarter. Woodson actually was leading for a majority of the game. They had it in control in the first half up until the last 28 seconds. They were up 26-24, back and forth game. Couple of quick points by South Lakes. Exclamation point by a Smith three-pointer at the buzzer. Banked it in, 30-26, South Lakes went in at the half. South Lakes head coach Wendell Bird said that was a big momentum changer going in because it kind of allowed South Lakes to say, we got this game, we're questioning Woodson. In the second half, Woodson opened up strong, cut the deficit back to one, but then South Lakes, again, quick 10-0 run to dump that lead back up to double digits. Woodson head coach Dave Craig called a couple of timeouts, was just screaming at his team. You could hear him slam the clipboard down a couple of times. In the fourth, they made a big run to start the fourth, aided by Zach Wilmot, who had 9 points in the quarter. They were able to cut it to 45-43, but again, South Lakes just put on the full court press, and Woodson just turned the ball over. Lead balloon back up to 12 before Woodson scored again, and by that point, it was just free throws down the stretch, and South Lakes ended up winning big.
And Paul, you also got a chance to see South Lakes in action. John, you mentioned a couple of key names that I want to touch on before we get to Paul, who did get a chance to see South Lakes versus Stonebridge. An interesting game for South Lakes, by the way. Monty Smith banked that three-pointer home. Monty Smith for South Lakes has taken over the role of superstar, really. I mean, for the South Lakes Seahawks, who have always had such a storied basketball program. Julian Vaughn left to go to Oak Hill Academy, and Monty Smith, a guard, has taken over that team. He's got about 12 points a game this year, but they're spreading it. They're spreading it evenly as well. I don't want to elevate Monty above his teammates because they are doing a great team effort. J.P. DePasso, a big man, getting a lot of looks as well at the next level. 10.5 points a game, and he's also tearing up the rebounds. And Curtis Keyes is scoring about 9.9 points a game for South Lakes. Here's a guy that didn't do a whole lot last year that's coming in to have a pretty good role with the Seahawks in Wendell Bird's last year. Now, speaking of that, Paul, you got a chance to see them, the South Lakes Stonebridge game. What did you see in that game, and what can you take away from that, though? What does that mean, big picture, for South Lakes?
Well, big picture for South Lakes, obviously, that one district loss is coming from Stonebridge. And Stonebridge is a little bit of an enigma here because I saw them at the beginning of the year, and they were not clicking at all. And what I see now as it's coming around is Wailu Brown, we all know him from football. Terrence Cohen, we all know him from football. They're helping out Brent McDaniel, who has been Stonebridge's star pretty much, you know, last year and the beginning of this year. What Wailu Brown is doing is just amazing. Against South Lakes, he puts up 18 points in the 58-55 win over South Lakes. Last year, that score was 85-39 wow. South Lakes. So Stonebridge definitely taking some leaps and bounds. Wailu Brown in the last two games puts up 25 points against Marshall, 21 points against Woodson, and he's not even supposed to be their star player. Hmm. Brent McDaniel is supposed to be their star player. So when you see Wailu really just in his first year with the Stonebridge basketball team, when you see him picking it up so much, that bodes well for the Bulldogs, and I'm waiting for that Liberty District tournament because they could make some noise.
And you know, Sonny Green is a heck of a coach uh-huh. over there, and now two coaches benefiting now from Devin Brown, yeah. the Liberty District and Northern Region Football's Offensive Player of the Year, transferring from Bishop O'Connell. Mickey Thompson, of course, mm-hmm. rode Devin Brown through a playoff series, and it looks to be that South Lakes, or excuse me, Stonebridge might get a chance to ride him through another postseason in just his only year at Stonebridge.
I'm sure that administration over at Stonebridge is checking for angel wings and a halo on Wailu Brown because he is seriously leading these two teams.
Okay, speaking of leading teams, I want to talk a little bit before we get to Coach Gary Hall and talk about the big Fairfax Sports Network Game of the Week coming up on Friday. I want to get a chance to talk a little bit about McLean. Justin DeVarney is a transfer over there who is helping out carry the load for Tariq Amori. McLean did suffer a setback, though, in their rivalry game. They were basically blown out by Langley, not something you see very often in a Langley-McLean game. Those are usually tight games. Amori held to just 7 points in that game, but he will graduate as the leading scorer in McLean basketball's history. This is a junior now who's scoring 15.1 points a game, finished last year with about 20 points a game. James Pasco, the lefty, also saw some time at quarterback during the football season, 8.9 points a game. And I did mention Justin DeVarney, also a junior. Him and Amori will be playing again for the Highlanders next year with Coach Drew Murphy. DeVarney, 9.2 points a game. Folks, this is a great time for us to break and bring to you Gary Hall, the coach of the Herndon Hornets. Before we bring him on with us, we want to show you the Concord District standings, why this Fairfax Sports Network Game of the Week will be so important, Paul. You look at the top half of the district.
You're looking at Herndon and Westfield, both 4-0 in the district, facing off against each other. Herndon has a 10-1 overall record, while Westfield has a 10-3 record. A little bit deceiving. Those two of those losses come from private schools, not in the northern region. You see Chantilly right there, too, getting their football players back, getting in the groove of things, 3-1 in the district, 7-5 overall. Robinson at 2-3 in the district, but a 500 record, 6-6 overall. Centerville, a little bit of a question mark right now. They're 1-3 in the district, but they're 8-5 overall, so they gotta put some district wins together in order to stay competitive in the district. Oakton at 1-4, 5-9 overall, and Fairfax at 0-4 in the district, 5-9 overall.
All right, folks, we've got an interesting graphic that we want to show you about Herndon versus Westfield. Before we do that, we're going to bring Gary Hall, the coach of Herndon High School, on with us. Coach Gary Hall recently won his 300th game at Herndon High School, putting him amongst the elite coaches in the northern region. Coach Hall, are you with us?
Hey, guys, I'm here.
Hey, Coach. Thanks for joining us. I appreciate you coming on the Fairfax Sports Report with us. We want to talk a little bit of Westfield with you real quick, but before we get to that, I got to ask you about that 300th win, Coach. How good was it to get that win? And we talked a little bit before the game and after the game. You also won that game against South Lakes. Talk a little bit about what that meant.
Oh, well, certainly. It was a great thrill just to have the opportunity to coach 300 games at high school level, much less win 300. And to have the opportunity to do that against a coach in a basketball program that I respect was really satisfying. It's a coach, Coach Bird, who gave me the opportunity to coach high school basketball, gave me my start at a gym in a school that is dear to my heart, and I had an opportunity to start coaching there. So I think it was fitting that we got our 300th win there.
And Coach, I was there for that game. What a game it was! The rivalry games are always good games, but you mentioned going into that game, you know, it meant a lot, but it wasn't a district game. When both teams were in the Concord district, it was really more of an important game. I think now looking at this Westfield game coming up Friday, you know, it's becoming more of a rivalry now between Herndon and Westfield because you guys are in the same district. Am I right?
Oh, there's no question. I think that, you know, Herndon South Lakes will always be a tremendous rivalry, but I think it's lost some of its luster just because it's no longer a district game where you're playing for a championship seeding in the region tournament. And Westfield, because of the success of the two programs, Herndon and Westfield, Westfield has, somewhat taken the place of South Lakes for us.
Right.
Now, Coach, you are seeing, you've seen a lot of Maurice Hubbard over the years, three times last year. What are you doing coaching-wise to prepare for a player such as Hubbard?
He's an outstanding talent, and we certainly have seen a lot of him, and unfortunately we'll have to see a lot more of him in the future. But he's a tremendous player, and he has a great supporting cast, and they're very well coached. So they're an outstanding high school basketball program. But there are some things that we're going to try to do to neutralize Maurice. But I think the big thing with him is if we can keep him off the glass. You know, we have pretty good post players ourselves, so we're going to go right at him, and maybe we can get him in foul trouble. And I think that, you know, that may decide the outcome of that game is whose big man gets in foul trouble. Is it going to be Maurice Hubbard at Westfield, or is it going to be Danny Jones at Herndon?
Now, Coach, what is going to be the more difficult part of game planning for Westfield? Is it going to be for their speed or just how deep they are? Because I covered a game when they played Robinson, and they just keep coming at you with players off the bench, and they are quick up and down the court.
Yeah, and that's true. You know, the thing about that is, I mean, they can only play five at a time. We feel like we have a pretty good basketball program. So, I mean, certainly we're going to do some things to game plan for Westfield, but Westfield's going to have to do some things to game plan for Herndon as well. And so we feel pretty good about our chances Friday night. We're playing on our home court, and, you know, and that's the, you know, the most difficult place to play in the Northern Region, if not the Washington, D.C. area with our fan base. So we like our chances, but we, you know, it's a situation where we certainly go into a game and we do a lot of scouting. We, you know, we break down film, we go out to see games, but it's something that we feel like if we take care of Herndon, then we're going to be okay.
And speaking of taking care of Herndon, Coach, you've been doing that for quite some time, and there was a guy that did that for the last 4 years alongside of you, someone you've known since he was 10 years old, like a second father to him, and it's probably good to be seeing him on TV and locally now coming back home to help beat the Georgetown Hoyas with Villanova, Scotty Reynolds. Talk a little bit, Coach, about what it's like to see him doing so well at the collegiate level. He's starting. He's a starting guard at Villanova. He dropped 25 points against DePaul the other night. I think he hit about 7 threes. What's it like, first of all, to see him do so well? And second of all, how difficult is it to not have him in a Herndon uniform?
Well, I tell you, it's much more difficult to watch the game and watch him play than it is to coach him. you certainly have an appreciation for what parents go through. And we go to games up at Villanova. I can't sit in my seat. I have to walk around the arena, and I'm poking my head in. And when you're on the sidelines with him, you feel like you have a little more control.
Right.
But Scotty's story has been told over and over, and I think he's a product of so many people. And, you know, the old saying, it takes a village, and certainly, you know, our community and the people that Scotty's been associated with has just, you know, done an outstanding job, and Scotty's done an outstanding job. So it was really nice to see the Northern Region and Washington, D.C. area turn out and support him on Monday night in his game against Georgetown. As far as replacing him, you never replace a Scotty Reynolds. You don't replace a Grant Hill. You don't replace a Maurice Hubbard. I mean, there's been a lot of great players in our region, and you don't replace those kids. The one thing that I talked to you earlier this year, and I talked to my players. We had a pretty good basketball program before Scotty came, and we feel like we're going to have a pretty good basketball program long after he's gone.
You can see that with already a 4-0 district record and 10-1 overall, so doing pretty good.
I think there's a major difference between having a good team and having a good program.
Right.
You know, teams can go, you know, they can pop up and be good for a year, but, you know, I think that we've been able to sustain a level of success for quite a number of years. And as far as, you know, the things that you don't replace, like the stats, the points per game, the rebounds, those things, you know, those are much easier to replace than the intangibles that Scotty brought, his leadership, his his work ethic, his basketball IQ, his confidence. And, you know, last year, no matter where we played, who we played, as long as number three was on the bus, we felt pretty good about our chances.
And, Coach, you've got some players right now still. You mentioned that you guys are a program, and you do seem to replenish very well. Danny Jones has done great for you this year. Matt Seeger, those two guys coming back from a great playoff run last year. Of course, Richard Gore looks to be a guy that has really stepped in and taken over some of that leadership role. Looks like he's a guy that people rally around in the locker room.
Oh, there's no question. And Rich did a lot of that for us last year. And he's, you know, Danny is probably our most talented player, best all-around player. You know, Rich is the one player that we can least afford to lose. I mean, he's the heart and soul of our team. And, I mean, he's just, I mean, he wills guys to victory. He does a lot of things that go unnoticed, you know, that don't show up in a box score on a stat sheet. And he's just a tremendous amount of energy for us. And there's no question that he is our leader out on the floor and in the locker room.
Coach, it's going to be a dogfight on Friday night. I love watching Herndon play Westfield. The Fairfax Sports Network will be there to cover that game. Coach, good luck in that game, and we'll see you afterwards, win or lose. I know you're only Absolutely. Thinking wins, right?
Absolutely. No, I look forward to it, and I appreciate you guys coming out on Friday night. It should be a good one.
Thanks, Coach.
All right, Coach. Thanks a lot.
Thanks, Coach.
Hey, thank you. Good night.
So Coach Gary Hull's got some choice words there. I mean, they're thinking only wins, and, well, maybe I put those words in his mouth. Yeah. But, you know, look, I mean, that's a game that we've got a graphic that we want to throw up on the screen to show our viewers at home who are going to be looking forward to that game. They can see the tail of the tape here. Paul Herndon at 9-1 overall right now and undefeated in the district, as are both teams.
You see, obviously, Westfield, like we said, 10-3. Those two of those losses coming to out-of-region private schools. 4-0 in the district, off to a great start as well. Last season, it was all Herndon. 69-55 Herndon. February 7th, it was 80-59. That was a blowout game for Herndon. And then in the district championship on February 17th, Herndon wins by double digits. Average margin of victory was 15 points. So this has been a Herndon-dominated rivalry, and I can't wait to see what happens on Friday.
Well, Paul, I mean, can't wait. That's the theme for Centerville. Mm-hmm. They cannot wait. Is it too late for Centerville to turn it around and get back in the district fight?
Well, unfortunately, I think it is too late for them to turn it around. They haven't. They're not a bad team by any stretch of the imagination. They're actually a very good team. They're winning the games they're supposed to win. But again, they're already 1-3. In the district, and their one district win comes against Fairfax, who's hasn't won in the district yet. So this is a tough district. I mean, by no stretch of the imagination, the Concord is still a tough district. So, you know, three losses in the district, I don't know if they're going to be competing for a regular season title, but they can still pick it up and go into that tournament.
John, we're going to ask you about Robinson, who's lost four out of the last five, in a minute here. But before we get to that, I want to ask Paul, I want to pick your brain a little bit about Ben Wheeler and the Chantilly Chargers. Mm-hmm. They're replenishing that team with some football players they lost. Tell me a little bit about them. You've gotten a chance to see them.
Well, when they first started, as Coach Wheeler said, as we mentioned on this show, in their first five games, their full team had only practiced three times.
Wow.
Because the fact that they had all those football players who went to the state championship right into the basketball season. So they started working together as a team. They started, as he said, we started practicing together, and they've definitely come around. They've won six of their last seven, including a win on Friday over Stewart that gave that gave Coach Smith his 300th win. And then right after that, on Tuesday, they come in and they beat Oakton to give Coach Smith his 301st win. So, I mean, a big thing that I noticed is watching Ben Wheeler, who before the season signed with Lafayette, so he's set to go play in college. The thing about Wheeler is he's a big, tall guy. He can hit a mid-range jumper from anywhere.
And I told you today, when you told me that about Ben Wheeler, because I've gotten limited opportunities to see Ben Wheeler play, and for a lack of better words, it's a good thing to be able to see a high school kid hit the mid-range jumper. Mm-hmm. It is such a lost art, and I'm glad that Ben can do that. What are some other of his other skills?
Well, definitely he's tall, so you have to respect him when he's driving to the lane. But what he does, he pulls up, hits that jumper, usually makes it. If he misses, he's not one of those kids that are going to shoot, think it's going in, and stand back and like raise his hands.
Right.
He's jumping in. He's getting his own rebound, another lost art in basketball. So I was impressed with him all the way around. He scored 21 points against Stewart to get Coach Smith, his 300th win. Scored 22 against Oakton. He's really putting it together, along with Nate Warwick, who's definitely also getting into the swing of things. And so the Chargers opened up 1-4. Since then, 6-7. They're definitely making a push, and you know, we'll see what happens there. But as for Coach Smith, obviously he's had a great career thus far. Had six in his 16-year run as a Chargers coach. He's only had three losing seasons.
Right.
So that bodes well for the Chargers. And between 95 and 98, his Chargers posted a 62-17 record. So obviously, this isn't a coach that, you know, has been around forever. So he limps to that win. He's putting together a great winning percentage also. So definitely congratulations to Coach Smith. And let's see how those Chargers do the rest of the season.
I want to get my Ben Wheeler throwback jersey. Sounds like a throwback player following his own shot, rebounding, mid-range jumpers. Wow. I don't see that in the high school level.
He's definitely a pleasure to watch and a great kid to boot. So.
All right, speaking of pleasure to watch, I can't say the same for the Robinson Rams. John, what's going on with Robinson?
Robinson's lost four of their last five after having a hot start. But if you look inside the box scores, they're facing tough teams. They've lost to Braddock, Centerville, Chantilly, Westfield, and Herndon with a one win against Oakton. It's not like they're playing cream puffs here. They're going with murderer's row. And so the four or five losing streak, it might be fool's gold, because if you don't have the athletes, which Coach Matt McCaig said he didn't have the athletes that Westfield did,
right,
it's hard to win those games.
Right.
You're starting to get a nice stretch here. They have Fairfax, Centerville, and Chantilly coming up, so they might be able to snag a couple wins and get the confidence back. The team still, they're not getting blown out. Last year, they won two games, were just getting rolled, game in and game out. The team is in these games until the third and fourth quarter. Even against Westfield, they were only down single digits midway through the third quarter before they ran out of gas at the end.
All right, well, we're just getting started with our guests here at the Fairfax Sports Report. Thanks for joining us here on the Fairfax Sports Report. I'm BJ Kubarulis from the Connection Newspapers, Paul Frumbelt of the Connection Newspapers, and John Marcario of the Connection Newspapers. We're going to break into our second half of the show now. We're going to talk a little bit of girls basketball. We're going to hit back on the boys basketball, so don't go too far. All right, John, work us through those Patriot District standings. We're going to throw it to you. We want you to just take us through that right now. The girls of Lee, a team that you've gotten a chance to see.
Lee High School at the top, 4-1 in district play, 8-1 overall. They are a legit team, a young team, so they could be good next year as well. West Springfield tied for first at 4-1 in district play, 8-3 overall. They could be the real deal this year. South County riding a good 4 or 5 winning streak. They're in third, 3-2 in district play, 8-3 overall. TC Williams at 3-2, 8-5 overall. TC could be struggling over the next 3 weeks as their best player, Tierra Ruffin Pratt, is out with a shoulder injury. So watch out for that. Annandale is 3-2, 6-7 overall. Lake Braddock, 2-3 in district play, 4-8 overall. Hayfield, 1-4 in district play, 1-10 overall. West Potomac trying to get their first district win, 0-4 in league play, 2-8 overall.
All right, you talk about league play, John, and you talk about a game that means so much to league play. That Lee-West Springfield game, you were at that game. You said it was quite the thriller. You got your money's worth, if you will. Tell us a little bit about that game.
That was the game. In the last 11 minutes of the game, West Springfield and Lee, neither team had a lead higher than 3 points. It was that good. Lee came all the way back from a 13-point deficit in the fourth quarter, off a three-pointer by Triera Hopkins. They took a 42-39 lead. West Springfield head coach Gibson called a timeout, talked to his team. He told us afterwards, "I just told them you have to get back to what you were doing that got you the lead." Bam, 6-0 run over the next 3 minutes. Lee fell in love with the long jumpers. They were not hitting them. West Springfield then, over the final 2 minutes of the game, turned the ball over 3 times as Lee had 4 chances to actually physically take the lead and just never could. And in the final seconds, they had a wide open look from 3-point range. Hopkins missed it. They got the offensive rebound, couldn't find another person open from 3-point range. She just started crying after the game. That's how much this game meant to Lee.
And you like to see that. You like to see emotion out of players.
Yes.
You like to see them really care about the wins and losses. And Lee is going to be growing up fast over there. John, you said they've got some young players, and they're going to be doing some great things next year. But don't write them off too fast, Northern Region fans. They'll be doing something this year as well. They're right up at the top of the girls' standings in the Patriot District. John, speaking of a team that's creeping up to the top of those district standings. The South County Stallions are a team that we thought, because they had two Division I players on their roster, and Lauren Ryan Shuttle and Laren Robinson, we thought they would be a team to be dealt with. Doesn't look like they've really lived up to that just yet, but there's still a whole lot of time left. They've got an 8-3 record right now. Mm-hmm. They're 3-2 in the district, so don't write them off just yet. I still believe in that team. How do you see that team shaking out?
They've won 6 of their last 7. They're tied. They're in third place right now in the Patriot. They're tied with TC. As we mentioned, TC's best player out for 3 weeks, so they should be able to capitalize on that. They've beaten Hayfield, West Potomac, Lake Braddock, North Stafford. They've lost to TC and West Springfield by double digits. So that could be a telltale sign right there. Don't quite hop on their train just yet. If you're losing to the upper echelon teams by double digits, that's not really a good sign. Moving forward, you can make adjustments in the second half, of course. They have big game coming up on Friday night. They host Lee. You got to wonder the psyche of that Lee team. They only have one senior on there coming back after that heartbreaking West Springfield loss. That is a big bounce back game for Lee and a big statement game for South County because they can creep into second place.
All right, speaking of top tier teams in not just that Patriot district, but in the northern region, Tierra Ruff and Pratt, John, you mentioned it. Mm-hmm. I want to make sure that our viewers at home know who she is. She's a player that drops over 20 points a game as a sophomore for a team that went deep into the playoffs last year because of her as a freshman. She's out now for 3 weeks with a hurt shoulder. So as you saw our Elite Eight poll mention, the TC Titans pretty high up in that poll. I don't think they'll stay there without Tierra, but it will be a good opportunity to test that team to see what they can do without their star player. In girls basketball, though, you often see it's a little bit more difficult to bounce back without that go-to person. Speaking of a go-to person, Edison surely has a go-to person in Darina Campbell. We want to talk a little bit about the National District's girls standings and show you how that district is currently shaking out. Edison at 4-0. Mount Vernon trailing behind at 4-1. Yorktown 3-1. This is all district play, of course, as you see the overall records to the right. Edison, yes, they did suffer a loss. The best team in the world, folks, who would win the world championship, has suffered a loss. We'll tell you a little bit about that later in the show. Falls Church right there in the middle of the pack at 2-2. Wakefield 1-3. Stewart 1-3. And winless Washington and Lee still looking to get on the board. John, we mentioned that Edison lost a game. Let's talk a little bit about that and what happened in that game. We mentioned in Westfield's case, they've only lost out-of-region games to private schools. Is that the same case with Edison?
No need to stop the press right now. Mm-hmm. The loss to Bishop McNamara, they are a legit East Suburban Catholic Conference school. They came in there highly rated. They have players. It's just they are a good team. Any of the Catholic schools around the area, it is tough for the public schools to play them. So don't get all excited. Don't say they're fading. It's one loss to a very good Catholics team.
Yeah, but if my memory serves me correctly, John, these Edison Eagles, as these folks have probably witnessed on our loop-de-loop of a month playback of our region preview, they were ranked pretty high themselves in the country by USA Today at number 5 and 6, depending on what week you looked at the poll, in the top 25 in the country. So not quite the game you would have thought they would have played against a team like that. They only lost by 6 points, though.
As you mentioned earlier, though, when we were talking, it's better to lose now than like Oakton did last year in the district. You'd rather lose in December than lose a game in February and March. You've got that one loss out of the way. I've always been under the philosophy, the longer you go in a season undefeated, the more pressure you have, the more tight you get. There's nothing good that comes out of being undefeated going into February and March.
Of course, you're talking about Oakton losing to Madison in the region tournament after posting 25 consecutive victories undefeated to start the season. They're looking to do better on that. We'll talk a little bit about the Oakton Cougars when we get to our Concord District girls part of the show. For now, we want to tell you, though, what Edison has been able to do. We're going to show you a couple of choice games that we picked out to show you their dominance in the region. These are only region games. Of course, they've played 14 total games, and that points forced and points allowed at the bottom averages those combined 14 games. But these are the games we want to show you in region. You see that they took it to West Springfield 55-39. They dispatched of T.C. Williams by more than 20 points. And you look at the Washington and Lee game, 93-11.
They were winning that game 66-3 at the half.
And 96-38 over Wakefield, 87-43 over Mount Vernon. Mount Vernon if you put this in perspective in that district, Mount Vernon is the second best team in that district.
If you just, since their loss, they've beat Mount Vernon by 37 and Yorktown by 37. They have Yorktown, or they have Falls Church and Stewart up next. Good luck.
And we'll be looking for Darina Campbell to quarterback the New England Patriots to success in this year's Super Bowl, folks. All right, let's move on to the Concord District girls standings. We want to throw it to our Paul Frummelt of the Connection
Paul.
Newspapers.
Your very own
our birthday
Paul
boy.
Frummelt. Okay, Oakton, you know, 5-0 in the district, 13-1 overall. Talk about Edison. Oakton's right there with them. Westfield keeping pace with 3-1 in the district, 10-4 overall. The surprising Centerville Wildcats at 3-1, 9-2 overall. And you got Chantilly there, 2-2, 8-4 overall. Then Herndon at 1-3, with 3-7. Robinson at 1-4, 7-6 overall. And then Fairfax still looking for that first district win, but 2-5 overall.
All right, so a team that just broke into our Connection Newspapers Elite Eight poll this week. Centerville, a team you covered. Tell us a little bit about them Wildcats.
Well, this is Coach Wally Horton's first year. He comes from Chantilly, who definitely knows how to play, knows how to coach them. So definitely, he's getting something from these kids that, you know, something that nobody really expected. You know, they're winning the games at 9-2, so they're definitely doing something right, and they're definitely competing in the Concord District. So.
Centerville right there in a tie with Westfield for second place in the Concord District. Look, to be honest here, that's really Oakton's district, and everybody else is just playing for second.
Exactly.
But at any point, somebody can jump up and challenge Oakton. I got a chance to see Oakton against Westfield before the break. I saw Jasmine Thomas score her 2,000th point against Westfield. Mm-hmm. But, Paul, let's jump ahead a little bit. We're going to talk about Chantilly as well, but let's talk a little bit about Westfield. Can they push and can they stay into the top tier?
Well, right now what we're seeing is they're winning the games again. They're winning the games they're supposed to, but they're losing some out-of-northern region games just like the boys have. They lost to Christ the King in New York City. They lost to C.D. Hilton, and their one loss comes to Oakton. So they're in that top tier, but their loss to Oakton was 46-28. So definitely not a close game. The same thing John was talking about. If you want to be in that top tier, you got to keep the games at least close.
And they did lose to Madison, a good team that's in our third place spot in our Elite Eight poll. Madison beat Westfield to advance to the finals of the Bulldog Bash, which was Westfield's home tournament. Madison only lost to Forest Park, last year's state title winner. We'll get a chance to talk a little bit about Madison girls when we get to our Liberty District part of the show. Before we get there, Paul, let's talk a little bit about Chantilly. They're on a bit of a streak.
Well, definitely the Chargers, they won four straight until they lost, guess who, to Oakton recently. So they beat George Mason, Thomas Jefferson, Stonebridge, and Fairfax. Not the hardest bunch of games, but still they're winning the games they're supposed to. They're 2-2 in the district, 8-4 overall. A big reason for that is Melissa Furr. She dropped 26 points in the Stonebridge game, and you know, they allowed Stonebridge only 9 first half points. So they're definitely when they're on their game, they're really an impressive team. They're staying healthy. Furr was out for the Oakton game, so that might say something. But right now, sitting here at 2-2 and 8-4 overall.
We mentioned it before, and I want to talk a little bit about Oakton because they are the class of that district. And well, maybe some would say of the region, them and Edison are going to get a chance to mix it up before this thing is said and done. That's something definitely people want to see, that matchup. Like I said, Jasmine Thomas scored her 2,000th point against Westfield before the holiday break. Jasmine, the 3-time Northern Region Player of the Year, headed for Duke, was a regular on this show, actually, during the holiday break. Just quite the player over there, but they've found some other role players around her. Ashley Abed she kind of causes matchup problems because she can get in and mix it up on the inside, and she can also hit that drop back and hit the three-pointer. Jackie Shoemaker has come on pretty strong, so I really like to see what Oakton can do in the postseason if they can make more of a push than they did last year. All right, let's move on to the Liberty District, a district, again, that has been very interesting for the girls as well as the boys. Let's show you what the current standings of the Liberty District look like right now. Right now, Madison at 5-0, undefeated in the district, 11-2. They were on a 7-game winning streak until they lost that game to Forest Park, as I mentioned in the Bulldog Bash. So they were second in that tournament. Marshall right there behind at 4-1. They are just starting to hit their stride under Coach Noel Klippenstein. 9-4 overall. Woodson right there in the top half of the district at 3-1 and 6-6. John's going to get a chance to tell us all about the Cavaliers at Woodson. McLean, I really liked what I saw out of them. Out of this past week's Fairfax Sports Network's Game of the Week, they took on Madison and almost made it a pair of upsets for the McLean Great Falls area. As we mentioned, the Langley boys upset Madison. McLean almost upset the Madison girls. Langley at 2-3 and just about 500 overall in the season. South Lake struggling still in the district. 3 wins total for that program last year, so they're already on the way to eclipsing that mark. Stonebridge, 6-7 overall, and Jefferson still winless in the district. All right, guys, when we talk about Liberty District girls basketball, we talk about Madison. Mm-hmm. Madison is a storied program that has won several region titles since the 90s. Madison coach Denise Weinig played there. She knows all about what Madison is capable of. Madison slept on McLean. I'm just going to be honest here. Mm-hmm. McLean came in the game of the week, and they made it the game of their week. Okay, they had already played one game that week. They came in. They were coming in from California, where they played their tournament, their holiday tournament. And they came in and took it to Mary Grace Jay, a 6'2" forward for the Warhawks. They took it to her with Caitlin Freeman, a guard, came in off the bench and scored 12 for McLean. Ashley Cole, of course, from McLean, a diverse slasher. She will graduate as the highest scorer in the history of McLean girls basketball, depending on the record books there. They're not 100% sure of the record books, but she's got just over 700 points on the season. Mm. And Jessica Stillman didn't have the greatest game against Madison, but she's like Ashley Abed from Oakton. She can get in there on the inside and she can drop back and hit the three. McLean was nursing some injuries as well as they have the entire season, but they really came in and took it to Madison. Katie Wimmer of Madison had a great game, and Natalie Surprise, playing with plantar fasciitis, came in and hit a huge three to keep Madison on top in that game when they needed her. She's just gotten about 10.5 minutes a game this year. She came in as a starter, but the injury has kept her on the sidelines. John, I want to get a chance to ask you about Woodson, but before we get there, got to drop some knowledge about Marshall.
Uh-oh.
Marshall right there at the top of the Liberty District, going to make a push. They did it last year with Amanda Brown. They got into the region tournament. They don't have her anymore. She graduated as the leading scorer in the history of that school, and right now Nicole Harrison has taken over that job and done quite well as the guard. They're distributing between the two big men, if you will, in KT Message and Maya Alshengeti. John, why are the Woodson Cavaliers, though, at the top half of the Liberty District standings?
Well, surprise, surprise right there. They are 3-1 in league play, 6-7 overall. They have a big league game tomorrow against Langley. It's big because Langley comes in middle of the pack. Those are teams, if you want to be in the upper echelon, you need to beat them. 5 of Woodson's 7 wins this year have been huge. They've been by double digits. A couple of their losses, though, such as their one to Oakton, first game of the year, they nearly lost by 30. They have not quite been tested yet, so once they get in the heart of league play, you'll be able to see how much they're made of. They've had good quality wins so far against Chantilly, McLean, as you were just talking about, just beat a so-so South Lakes team. And so we're going to have to wait and see how Pat Neary's team does when they start playing some legit teams.
And the Langleys of the world will not be happy to hear you call them the middle of the packs, because that is a team under Coach Cheryl Botho in the last 8 years has made the Northern Region Tournament 7 of the last 8 years. So, John, middle of the pack. You can send your emails, too. But really, no, John, right now you're right. They are middle of the pack, and over there at Langley that is not accepted and won't be taken for too long. So they're going to have to turn it around. I have faith in those Saxons, though. They did lose a high score from last year, but they do have some post players that can get it done. Let's move on to the Patriot District boys. We're back into boys basketball. John, take us through the Patriot District boys standings.
At the top, you have the powerhouse T.C. Williams, 5-0 in district play, 9-3 overall. Just beat Braddock, who's second, 4-1 in district play, 9-5 overall. Speak about that game in a little bit. West Springfield could be a little surprising team. They're in third, 4-1 in district play, 11-2 overall. Could be a little fool's gold there, though. West Potomac 4th, 3-2 in district play, 6-5 overall. Annandale Adams 2-3 in district play, 4-8 overall. South County Stallions, have a little note about them. They're 1-4 in district play, 5-7 overall. Hayfield 0-3 in district play, 3-7 overall. And Lee 0-5 in district play, 2-9 overall, having a rough year.
All right, John. You have been singing the praises of Brian Metris and the Lake Braddock Bruins. Take your 4 or 5 minutes and sing away, my friend.
We are going to tone it down a skosh.
A skosh.
They have two of their three losses this year have been to Herndon by 7 over the holiday, and they just lost to TC by double digits, so we're going to turn down.
But you know what? Those are legitimate losses.
Yes.
To lose to those teams, I believe, to only lose to Herndon by 7, John, is a feat in itself. Now, you don't want to tell them that, and they're not going to hear that because they want to win the games. But, you know, those are legitimate losses. If you're going to lose to somebody, those are the teams to lose.
Yeah, they are 1-2 in our connection top 8, so you're not talking about bad losses. Against TC, they just wore out at the end. They were actually up 1 in the third quarter, but just they ran out of gas. Their leading scorer, Greg Delaney, was held to 8. You can't win when he's held to 8 points. TC's Mike Davis had somewhere between 11 and 18 blocks for the game. It depends on who you talk to and what the official box score said. That's monster down low. He was swatting shots around left and right.
And we had a reporter at that game from the Connection newspapers. You can read about that story. I believe it was 14 blocks. You can read about that at theconnectionnewspapers.com, www.connectionnewspapers.com. Just click on any area of coverage that you like and click on sports, and you can read about guys who do have that many blocks in a game. You don't hear about that. That's got to be a school record.
They weren't officially sure of that, but that is a lot of blocks for Mr. Davis in that
14
game.
14 blocks.
14. But I mean, Braddock has got some solid wins this year. They've beaten Edison, Woodson, and West Springfield. They worked West Springfield. They beat them by 16 points. So don't quite discredit them yet. They have lost to TC Williams 3 times in a row. And so it's just tough for them. I mean, TC, they have their 3 losses like we spoke about. They have losses to Towson Catholic, Riverside, and Tri-City. Riverside and Tri-City are 2 teams out of state, so you are not talking about bad losses by any stretch of the imagination.
All right, John, I'm going to ask you about West Springfield in a minute here, but you did mention some private schools there, so I want to mention that coming up in late January, TC Williams will be playing Stu Vetter's Montrose Christian team, a team that just put, some believe to be the number 1 or number 2 draft pick, Kevin Durant, into college basketball. Of course, he's leading Texas in just about every statistical category, so you see the quality of that program. TC Williams got that game, and kudos to TC for taking that game to take on that long-lived battle. Who's better, public or private, John? Speaking here, though, we're talking about public school, and when we do, we're talking about West Springfield in the Patriot District. What has West Springfield been able to do to get to that 11-2 overall record and stay in the top half of that district?
West Springfield is 11-2. That we're going to get that out there front and center. Like I mentioned, though, that could be some fool's gold right there. They have not played the best competition in the world. They played Braddock, one of their better teams they played, lost by 16. They lost a game in the Oscar Smith tournament against a good team. Not a good sign. They have wins over Annandale, South County, Lee, McLean, Fairfax, West Potomac. We are not talking about world beaters here.
Right.
So they have talent on that team. They are very optimistic over there that they can get the job done. They won 20-plus games last year. It's just you want to see that team play more games where they're tested. They will have that coming up the 16th, Tuesday night, against TC Williams. It's at West Springfield. That will be a war because West Springfield needs that game as a statement to say, hey, we are here. We are ready this season to do something.
All right. Has South County made that statement yet? They lost a rivalry game to Hayfield. And, John, if I remember, that score was pretty lopsided. Hayfield comes in and really takes it to their rival.
Going into the season, people were talking South County. Talked to the players. They're saying, we bought into the system. They struggled last year, won 2 or 3 games. The players said it's a lot of individualism, a lot of me, me, me. I don't buy into the system. I can't trust my teammates because they're all brand new. They didn't know each other. But going into this year, they said, we're going to get it done. They are 1-4 in district play. Very, very puzzling. 5-7 overall. More puzzling. They just had, though, a big warning sign. You lose by 25 points to Hayfield, who came into the game with a 1-6 record in league play and 4-8 overall. That game's at home. You do not lose to your rival, who is not a good team, by 25 points. If you want to be anywhere close to a legitimate contender for any kind of anything whatsoever, they have games coming up against Lee, Annandale, and West Potomac, so they can right the ship a little bit. It's just you got to wonder what's going on down there when you lose by 25 points to your rival
at home. Okay, John, final thoughts on T.C. Williams and Lake Braddock game in the Patriot District. That was a game last night. What are your final thoughts on that game?
When you go to T.C., it's a tough game. We spoke about this in the office. You thought T.C. would kind of handle them. I said, Braddock's got this one. I talked to the coach a little bit before the game. He was a little bit worried how they were practicing. Kind of came to fruition in the game because it was a sloppy game played, and you can't play sloppy and beat T.C. Williams.
Okay. Don't play sloppy, and these are the teams that haven't played sloppy. Ooh, of course, we're talking about our Elite Eight from the Connection newspapers. You can find this every week in the Connection newspapers, our Elite Eight. Of course, it's a voting system between all of us sports writers in the office. BJ, why don't you tell us a little bit about the boys of the Elite Eight? Come on, bring me the Elite Eight, and I'll show you all about the boys. BJ, me. Herndon, 9-1, 31 votes. Previously, number one. We talked to Coach Gary Hall of the Herndon Hornets. They're going to be game planning for Westfield. That will be the Fairfax Sports Network's Game of the Week this Friday. T.C. Williams right behind them. John, that's a team that you believe in. Westfield, 10-3. South Lakes right behind them, 8-4, 22 and 20 votes respectively. Wakefield at 10-1. What a team that is. Lake Braddock, 8 votes. Madison, 6 votes. Of course, that hurt them after that upset loss to Langley. I'm sure they'll climb back up, though. I think they learned their lesson, and they've come down to earth a little bit. West Springfield at 10-2, and Woodson at 7-5. Those are the teams of our Elite Eight poll in the Northern Region Connection Newspapers Elite Eight poll. All right, we want to get a chance to show you, of course, the girls' Elite Eight and show you what these girls have been able to do during the time that we were away from the office. John, why don't you tell us a little bit about the Elite Eight top teams?
Numero uno, we have Edison, a.k.a. the New England Patriots. They are 12-1 with 32 votes. Number two right behind them, Oakton, 12-1 with 21 votes. Madison is third. They are 8-2, getting 16 votes. The Lee Lancers, who play a good game this weekend against South County on Friday night, fourth with 14 votes. They are 8-0. T.C. Williams, who will be without their leading player for 3 weeks, fifth at 8-4 with 12 votes. Westfield, 6-9-4 with 11 votes. West Springfield, who will rise next week with their win over Lee, they are 7th with 9 votes. And Centerville, the newly minted Centerville, they are 8th, 9-2 with 6 votes.
Okay, folks. At home, if you haven't gotten a chance to see the story, you can see it on www.connectionnewspapers.com. Just click on any locality in sports, and you'll see that the state swim meet is in a bit of jeopardy. I got a chance to talk to Oakton DSA Phil Levine this week. Phil Levine ran that state swim meet as the director of the meet after running the Concord District, the Northern Region. He then ran the state swim meet at the Fairfax campus of George Mason University. That's where all the teams from the state come to compete. 600 entries, a round number there, somewhere around 600 entries last year in the state meet. This year, it may not happen. Why? No one wants to step up and be the meet director. Right now, they have a slot. They have a place to run it at the Prince William campus of George Mason University. There's only 4 pools in the state that are capable of holding this event in their size: UVA, Radford, and the 2 Northern Virginia campuses of George Mason. But they don't have a director. Phil Levine did it last year, and through an unspoken or unwritten agreement put in place by the Virginia High School League last year, it will rotate between the Northern Region and the Northwest Region. The Northern Region did it at the Fairfax campus last year. It's the Northwest Region's turn to do it at the Prince William campus this year, according, of course, to Oakton DSA Phil Levine. Okay, with that said, I've done a little research. I've talked to some of the people from around the state, and it looks like there is a group of parents in the Commonwealth District, which is down towards the Richmond area, that are rallying to get this thing together, to try to get a meet director. And it looks like it may not even be at the Prince William campus of George Mason University. Now that means our swimmers are going to have to travel to compete at the state meet. So within 2 weeks, if there's no meet director, there will be no state swim meet, or the swimmers will have to travel, which is a thing in its own, but at least there will be a meet. But still, it most likely will be at what I'm hearing through the rumblings is Brook Point High School, which is a high school down south, and their facility supposedly cannot handle this event. I talked to Tom Dolan of the VHSL, and he told me, because he is the VHSL's point of contact for swimming, he told me this week, he said, if a school from the Virginia Beach area were to step up and say, hey, we'll host it, everybody's going to Virginia Beach, even though the pool in Virginia Beach, because of a construction error, is about 2 inches short. So every record in the history of the state could be broken this year, if there even is a state tournament. So this thing is certainly a quagmire. Paul, a former swimmer yourself, you know, tell me the Northwest region should step up here, mm-hmm. shouldn't they?
I believe the main problem that happened is this informal, unwritten agreement. And when you do something like that, you're bound to run over problems. No one wants to host this because it doesn't make them money. And
right.
I can agree. I think it's you got to think about these kids here. And I believe that's what the Northern region is doing. They're trying to get this done.
Yep.
But you have to sit down and write some kind of contract. Who's going to host these meets? Because this could happen again. And that's just bad. It hurts the kids who want to compete at this state level.
Phil Levine has always been a fan of swimming, so mm-hmm. he's even offered to step in and do some of the entry forms and all that stuff. He just can't run it after doing the Concord, the Northern region, and the state, and they're going to have him do it in 2008, mm-hmm. the same routine, 3 years in a row. Guys, that's asking a little much. John, your final thoughts on the state swim meet.
Guys, where do we live? Northern Virginia.
Yes.
Paul spoke about money. When has money ever been a problem for people in Northern Virginia? It has never been a problem. If money is an issue, step up and do it.
Well, it's, you know, there's a little bit more to be said than that. And if you want to look into the numbers and figures of what this thing has costed and will cost, you can read that at connectionnewspapers.com. We want to thank the folks that make this show possible. Of course, they make the FSN Game of the Week possible. Westfield at Herndon, and games will be available on digital cable on demand.
It's going to be a good game.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I want to thank Pete Masisco, of course, and happy birthday. And happy birthday to Paul Frummelt.
Me.
The FSN Game of the Week will re-air on Cox Channel 10 this week. The 2007 Bulldog Bash holiday basketball tournament. It was taped on December 19th and December 30th, and it's going to run at 4:30 on Monday and 3:30 on Cox. FSN, we're on the web, fairfaxsportsnetwork.com. CCI Screen Printing, thank you. Quality Care Ford Service Center.
Ha, 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 ha.